Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 11th of November 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis, along with the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi, Trivandrum and Hyderabad editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion is available in the description section and also in the comment section for the benefit of the smartphone users. Let us now start our analysis. This editorial discusses about India's position in the world economy and the effect of withdrawal from RCEP on India. The syllabus that can be linked to the analysis of this editorial is given here for your reference. In this editorial, firstly, the author discusses about the economic structures in Asia today. According to the author, there are two economic structures in Asia now. One is the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, that is the RCEP. And the next is the Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership, or in short, CPTPP. In this, we have discussed many times regarding this RCEP agreement, because India has pulled out of the RCEP agreement and we have been discussing about this for the past 1 or 2 weeks. The next agreement which we saw is the CPTPP, which is a free trade agreement between 11 countries. The 11 countries are Canada plus 10 other countries in the Asia Pacific region, which are the countries of Australia, Brunei, Chile, Japan, Malaysia, Mexico, New Zealand, Peru, Singapore and Vietnam. This CPTPP incorporates the provisions of Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement. And once this CPTPP is fully implemented, the 11 countries will form a trading bloc. And this trading bloc will represent 495 million consumers and it will comprise about 13.5% of the global GDP. So from this we can see that India is not a member of this CPTPP agreement as well. And we just saw that India is also pulled out of the RCEP agreement. Apart from this, we also saw during one of our editorial discussion in the last week that India is not a part of Chiang Mai initiative and it is also not a part of APEC, that is the Asia Pacific Economic Cooperation. So we can tell that India is not a part of the major economic blocs in the Asia Pacific region. In this context, the author discusses about the repercussions of India's decision on RCEP and why India took such a decision. India decided to withdraw from RCEP, stating its national interest and its internal ambitions. A long-standing goal for India is to generate a high level of sustained economic growth. According to economic growth, sustained economic growth matters for two reasons. The first reason is with respect to its effects within India, wherein the sustained economic growth will pave way for expansion of many sectors and companies, thereby creating huge job opportunities. So it will help to secure a stable future for India's young population. So these are the effects within India. The second reason is with respect to its effects externally, that is outside India. A sustained economic growth will put India in world's economic power map externally. So it will facilitate India to rise as one of the poles in a multipolar world. Now let's see what is meant by unipolar. Unipolarity or unipolar in international politics means the distribution of power in which there is one state with most of the cultural, economic and military influence. Whereas the term multipolar or multipolarity in international politics means the distribution of power in which more than two nation states have nearly equal amounts of military, cultural and economic influence. Now you can take the example of United States of America and then the Soviet Union. When Soviet Union was there, it was a multipolar world. After that, it was a unipolar world with USA as the main pole. Now again, multipolarity is rising in the world with China, India and other countries in the picture. Even in the year 2014, our Prime Minister articulated the same vision of India being a pole in the multipolar world. For this, the Indian government focused on promoting the manufacturing sector. And based on this, the Make in India program was launched. This program, among other things, also encouraged the global companies to manufacture products in India. And this program was aimed at creating employment and self-employment opportunities for our youth. And it also aims to make India a global manufacturing hub. So these are India's economic interests which you need to know. Make in India and promote manufacturing within India. Now this is relevant in the context of India's decision on RCEP, why India did not join RCEP. In our previous classes, we have discussed quite a lot of concerns again and again, and we shall be seeing certain concerns now which might be repetitive. Here in this editorial, the author quotes few concerns why India decided to stay away from RCEP. First is the negative impact with respect to farmers and small business owners. And the second is the lack of concessions within the final agreement on key demands of India like work visas and liberalization in services sector. Then with respect to visas, India demanded easier work visas for its software outsourcing sector within the RCEP area because this was expected to facilitate easier movement of workers and professionals between the RCEP countries. But the thing was that it was not agreed by many of the countries. Then the next concern is regarding India's trade deficit and how those deficits would expand under the RCEP. We have seen many times that India currently has deficits with 11 out of the 15 other member states of RCEP. Now this last concern is critical with respect to China, that is the China factor. It is because India fears about the influx of cheap Chinese imports into India. So invariably, it will affect India's manufacturing sector and thus it is against India's Make in India program. Now this concern is supported by legitimate facts according to author. It is because even the Minister for External Affairs of India has argued that India has faced unfair restricted market access from China when India exports to China. Then the Foreign Secretary of India also pointed to millions of non-tariff barriers in China, and he also accused China of dumping. Here the term non-tariff barrier means restricting a trade through other means like quotas, embargoes, sanctions, etc. And the term dumping in simple words mean selling a Chinese product at lower price in India while the same Chinese product is sold at a higher price in China itself. So they are trying to dump the Chinese products in Indian markets. So these are some of the concerns which the author has mentioned in this editorial. According to the author, even though India has these concerns, withdrawing from RCEP agreement is not the solution. It is because India had already won concessions such as protocol implementation delays of WTO protocols, etc. And also India's having some safeguards to protect sensitive sectors like agriculture. Here maybe the author is referring to the World Trade Organization ministerial meet in Bali. In this meet, if you see, India had secured a major victory by safeguarding its food security program and won against the US and the European Union. In addition to this, the World Trade Organization has certain provisions which allow India to impose safeguard duties and anti-dumping duties. According to author, these provisions are already being used by India against China. So India can continue to use these provisions against China whenever there are unfair trade practices being practiced by China. But instead of doing all these measures, India is withdrawn from the RCEP and the author is not okay with India's decision. So the author is calling this move of India as India's inability to translate its ambitions into action. Why the author is telling this is because India's enormous strategic and long-term economic imperatives or essentials to join the RCEP. If India's ambition is really to become a global hub for manufacturing, then it means that India's long-term national interest must be to integrate into global value chains such as RCEP and the CPTPP. Because according to author, in future, these agreements will effectively determine the global value chains for manufacturing in Asia. But as we just saw, India is not a part of neither of these agreements. So India will continue to remain unintegrated in these value chains or supply chains. So according to the author, this will further delay India's ambition of becoming a global manufacturing hub. In addition to this, this delay in integrating with global value chains will impact India's internal and external ambitions. It is because according to World Bank, domestic reforms plus integrating with global value can boost growth, create better jobs and reduce poverty. And according to the author, the jobs linked to global value chains provide one-third more pay than those jobs that are focused on the domestic market. So the inability of India to accede to RCEP and ensure India's integration into these emerging global value chains means India will lose key opportunity to create such high quality and high paying jobs. because these are the nation's interests as stated by India, which we saw above. That is why the author calls this move of India to withdraw from RCEP as India's inability to translate its ambitions into action. Moreover, if India would have signed the deal, then it would have made India into a key player and rule maker on the world stage. But now, India's absence in both of Asia's key economic architectures or agreements will affect India's goals as a regional power and Indo-Pacific power. So it will affect India's goal to be a prospective global power in the future. Hence, the author concludes the editorial with some questions, such as, first, will India translate this withdrawal from RCEP into a commitment for domestic reforms so that India can prepare itself for the next opportunity to integrate itself into the global value chains, and India can unleash Indian manufacturing to the world, which in turn will increase our exports and will solve the problem of trade deficit. Or secondly, will India revise its national interest ambitions and India will choose to remain isolated and sitting alone in a corner? According to author, the first question and a path to achieve it will only profit India. So let us wait and see what is our government's next move. To summarize this editorial, the author has discussed the implications or the setbacks that India is likely to suffer by pulling out from the RCEP deal and staying out of yet another Asia-Pacific deal, which is CPTPP. Let us move on to the next news article. Next, let us see two news articles regarding the former Chief Election Commissioner, T.N. Session, who passed away yesterday. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of both these news articles is given here for your reference. Know that Mr. T.N. Session was the 10th Chief Election Commissioner of India from 1990 to 1996. He was a Tamil Nadu cadre IAS officer. Later, he worked in the Central Cadre. And then in 1990, he became the 10th Chief Election Commissioner of India. He is best known as the man who cleaned Indian elections. It was during his tenure, he reformed the entire Indian electoral system by largely ending the electoral malpractices that happened during the elections. In one of the news article, few achievements of Mr. T.N. Session has been mentioned. Let us see some of the important achievements that were carried out by him during his tenure. It was Mr. T.N. Session who introduced photo identity cards for all the eligible voters. Introduction of photo identity cards for the electors ensured that no one else is voting on behalf of the registered voter. Next, we know that the Election Commission of India releases a set of guidelines, which is called as the Model Code of Conduct during the time of elections. These guidelines give the overview to the political parties and also to the candidates about what to do and what not to do during the election period. Before Mr. T.N. Session's tenure, this Model Code of Conduct was considered as a document of academic interest. It simply means that it was not at all considered important. But it was during Mr. T.N. Session's tenure, these guidelines were strictly enforced. So as a Chief Election Commissioner, Mr. T.N. Session strictly observed the prohibition of distribution of liquor or money during elections. Also, he prohibited bribing or intimidating voters. And he also prohibited the use of official machinery for campaigning. Then he prohibited candidates from demanding votes on the basis of caste or communal feelings, etc. It was a tough time for the political parties during his tenure to act on their interests. It was for his actions against corruption and electoral malpractices that Mr. T.N. Session was awarded the Ramon Magsaysay Award in the year 1996. See, this Ramon Magsaysay Award is considered as Asia's premier prize and the highest honor. This is about Mr. T.N. Session, the former Chief Election Commissioner of India, in brief. Now, in connection with both these news articles, let us discuss in brief about the constitutional provisions regarding the Election Commission of India and then about the Office of Chief Election Commissioner and other election commissioners. Let us start with the Election Commission of India. The Election Commission of India is a permanent and an independent body which is established by the Constitution of India. The main purpose of Election Commission is to ensure free and fair elections in India. And know that Election Commission of India is mentioned in Article 324 of Indian Constitution. So we can also tell that Election Commission of India is a constitutional body. Now this Article 324 provides that the power of superintendence, direction and control of the elections to the Parliament, State Legislatures, the Office of President of India and the Office of Vice President of India shall be vested in the Election Commission. It means the Election Commission of India has the power to manage the elections of all these offices that we saw. Since it also includes state legislatures, this Election Commission of India is an all India body. It is common to both the central government and also to the state governments. Here, one thing to note is that the Election Commission of India is not concerned with the elections to panchayats and municipalities in the states. It is the duty of the respective state election commissions. Next, let us discuss the composition of the Election Commission of India. Article 324 of Indian Constitution says that the Election Commission of India shall consist of the Chief Election Commissioner and such number of other election commissioners, if any, as the President may from time to time fix. And this article also says that the appointment of the Chief Election Commissioner and other election commissioners shall be made by the President. So, when any other election commissioner is appointed, then the Chief Election Commissioner acts as the Chairman of the Election Commission of India. Note that at present, the Election Commission of India has one Chief Election Commissioner and two election commissioners. The Chief Election Commissioner and the two other election commissioners have equal powers and they receive equal salary, allowances and other perquisites. And in case of difference of opinion among the Chief Election Commissioner and or the two other election commissioners, then the matter is decided by the commission by majority. That is, say if there are three persons and if two persons agrees to a decision, then the majority rules. Also know that Article 324 of Indian Constitution mentions that the conditions of service and tenure of the Office of Election Commissioners shall be determined by the President. And at present, if you see, both the Chief Election Commissioner and the other election commissioners hold office for a term of 6 years or until they attain the age of 65 years, whichever is earlier. And also note that they can resign at any point of time and they can also be removed before the expiry of their term. Now, let us discuss the provisions in Article 324 to ensure the independent and impartial functioning of the Election Commission of India. First is the security of tenure which is given to the Chief Election Commissioner. See, the Chief Election Commissioner cannot be removed from his office except in the same manner and on the same grounds as a judge of the Supreme Court. It means that the Chief Election Commissioner can be removed by the President on the basis of a resolution that is passed to that effect by both the Houses of the Parliament with special majority. So, only when both the Houses of the Parliament, that is the Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, passes a resolution with special majority to remove the Chief Election Commissioner, then he can be removed by the President. Now, let us see the grounds for removal. It can either be the incapacity to serve the position or proved misbehavior. Another provision is that the service conditions of the Chief Election Commissioner cannot be varied to his disadvantage after his appointment. Article 324 of Indian Constitution also tells that the other election commissioners cannot be removed from office except on the recommendation of the Chief Election Commissioner. Here, you have to note that the appointment of the election commissioners also has some inherent flaws. First is that the constitution has not prescribed the qualifications of the members of election commission. Like if they should have some legal experience or some educational experience or some administrative or judicial experience. So, this means that mostly the serving or the retired bureaucrats will be occupying the top positions in the election commission. Secondly, the Constitution of India has not specified the term of the members of the Election Commission. This means that the ruling government can change the term of office of the election commissioners. And thirdly, the Constitution of India has not debarred the retiring election commissioners from any further appointment by the government. So, this might result in conflict of interest as the government could reappoint the election commissioners favoring them. Now, let us discuss in brief about some of the important powers and functions of the Election Commission. See, the Election Commission of India determines the territorial areas of the electoral constituencies throughout India on the basis of the Delimitation Act, that is the Delimitation Act of 2002. Then the Election Commission prepares and periodically revises the electoral rolls and it also registers all the eligible voters. Then the Election Commission grants recognition to the political parties and it also allots election symbols to them. Next, the Election Commission settles disputes related to granting of recognition to the political parties and it also settles disputes in relation to the allotment of election symbols to the political parties. Then the Election Commission also determines the code of conduct to be observed by the parties and the candidates at the time of elections. These are some of the important powers and functions of the Election Commission of India. To summarize this news article, we have seen about the former Chief Election Commissioner, about the initiatives that he brought to revamp the Indian electoral system. Then we saw in brief about the Election Commission of India and about the composition of the Election Commission of India. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is regarding the development in importing the dried distillers grains with solubles from other countries such as the United States. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. In this news article, first we shall be seeing the background of this GM maize issue. Then we shall be seeing what is meant by GM maize in brief. And finally, we'll be seeing about genetic engineering appraisal committee. As we just saw, this news article is regarding the dried distillers grains with solubles. Know that this is derived out of GM corn or GM maize, and this DDGS is an excellent animal feed. Now let us see the background of this issue. Know that Karnataka state is one of the top poultry producing state in India. As we know, the poultry farmers mainly depend on maize as the chief feed, that is the primary animal feed. But for months, we have been hearing news that the poultry farmers and the poultry breeders in the state of Karnataka are facing a shortage of indigenously grown maize in order to feed the poultry. It was mainly because of drought and pest attacks which severely impacted the maize production. So in order to overcome this issue, the poultry farmers had long been pushing for the import of genetically modified maize. So what is this genetically modified maize? Or sometimes it is even called as genetically modified corn. According to World Health Organization, genetically modified organisms can be defined as organisms. It can be plants, animals, or microorganisms in which the genetic material has been altered in such a way that it does not occur naturally by mating or by natural recombination. So those organisms whose genetic material has been altered are called as genetically modified organisms. And maize or corn is also one such plant which has been subjected to genetic modification. And now this genetically modified maize or the genetically modified corn is available in abundance throughout the world. And if you compare the price, it is quite cheaper when compared to non-GM maize. This is the reason why the poultry breeders from the state of Karnataka are pushing for the import of genetically modified maize. Now let us come to today's article. It says that the Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee is expected to take up a report on the guidelines for import of dried distillers grains with solubles. We just saw that this DDGS is primarily used as an animal feed. It acts as a rich source of nutrient for animal feed and also for aqua feed, that is for the aquatic animals like fishes. Here you need to know that this dried distillers grains with solubles or DDGS is a major byproduct of the fuel ethanol, that is bioethanol. So this DDGS is obtained in large amounts from the ethanol industry, especially in USA. And if you see, the corn that is grown in US and many other Western countries are primarily genetically modified corn or GM corn. And this GM corn is one of the important input for producing bioethanol, which is an alternate fuel. Now, during the process, the starch content in the corn, that is the maize, is fermented in order to get ethanol. And the remainder is called as DDGS or the dried distillers grains with solubles. This DDGS is rich in energy, protein, and highly digestible phosphorus. So all these factors make this DDGS as one of the best animal feed and aqua feed. And at present, the United States and many other Western nations use DDGS as animal feed. And now the poultry breeders of Karnataka are also pushing to import DDGS as animal feed. But the import of this DDGS, which is derived out of GM corn, requires the permission of Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. So now let us discuss in brief about this Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. Know that the Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee functions under the Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. Now let us see the main functions of this Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. The first function is that this GEAC is responsible for appraisal of activities that involve large-scale use of hazardous microorganisms and recombinants in research area and in industrial production from the environmental angle. Then this GEAC is also responsible for the appraisal of proposals relating to the release of genetically engineered or genetically modified organisms and products into the environment, including experimental field trials. So this indicates that the import of DDGS, which is made out of GM corn, will require permission from Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. One more function of Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee is that this committee or any persons authorized by this committee has powers to take punitive action under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. This Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee is chaired by the Special Secretary or the Additional Secretary of the Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change, and it is co-chaired by a representative from the Department of Biotechnology. To summarize this news article, we have seen about dried distillers grains with solubles and then about the background of the issue, that is importing this DDGS into India, and then we saw in brief about GM maize and Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This about dengue. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. This news article states that Delhi has seen fewer cases and no deaths due to dengue. The Chief Minister of Delhi has noted that this was due to the success of the campaign against dengue. The campaign name is 10 Hafte, 10 Baje, 10 Minute. This campaign was started 10 weeks back in the month of September. The campaign has managed to control the spread of the disease dengue. Now let us see what is this campaign, 10 Hafte, 10 Baje, 10 Minute. This literally means 10 week at 10 o'clock for 10 minutes. The campaign required people to look for or check for the stagnant water in and around their homes for 10 minutes at 10 a.m. every Sunday for 10 weeks. That is why the campaign is named as 10 Hafte, 10 Baje, 10 Minute, or 10 week at 10 o'clock for 10 minutes. After this checking, people have to dispose the stagnant water. This is mainly to prevent the breeding of mosquito larvae, as they tend to breed in stagnant water. See, this campaign was run by the government of Delhi. Under the campaign, the Delhi government requested the cooperation of the Delhiites to keep the city free from vector-borne diseases such as dengue, chikungunya and malaria. The Delhi government sought the help of celebrities to popularize the campaign, and the campaign was promoted in schools as well. Awareness campaigns were conducted in schools to educate the parents as well as students about the causes and prevention of vector-borne disease, dengue. This topic is important from examination purpose, as it is a measure taken by the government to tackle the problem of dengue. You can mention this as an example in your mains answer writing. Now let us see some facts about dengue from prelims perspective. See, dengue is a mosquito-borne viral infection. The dengue virus belongs to the genus Flavivirus and the family Flaviviridae. The main vector that transmits the viruses which causes dengue is the Aedes aegypti mosquito. Here the term vector is nothing but an organism such as a biting insect that transmits a disease or parasite from one animal or plant to another. In case of dengue, the viruses are passed on to humans from the bites of an infective female Aedes aegypti mosquito. This mosquito mainly acquires the virus while feeding on the blood of an infected person, if you see. So once infected, the humans become the main carriers and multipliers of the virus, and they serve as a source of virus for the uninfected mosquitoes. And if you see, there is no specific treatment for dengue fever, so the patients should seek medical advice. They should take proper rest and drink plenty of fluids. Paracetamol can be taken to bring down fever and reduce the joint pains. And aspirin or ibuprofen should not be taken since they can increase the risk of bleeding. So this is all you need to know about dengue from prelims perspective. Now have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about the responses received by the central government to draft the Social Security Code. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this news article is given here for your reference. In the context of this news article, let us focus on four labor codes, including the social security code that is mentioned in the news article, then we shall see why these codes are needed and also certain concerns raised for enacting these codes by the government. See, based on the recommendations of the Second National Commission on Labour, the Ministry of Labour and Employment of the Government of India has initiated steps for formulating four labour codes. One is the code on wages, next is the code on industrial relations, then the code on social security and welfare, and finally the code on occupational safety, health and working conditions. See, all these codes are aimed at simplifying and rationalizing the relevant provisions of the existing 44 central labor laws. And the four labor codes that we just saw will contain provisions relating to wage, social security, safety, health and grievance redressal mechanism for the workers. So this initiative is expected to provide wage security, social security, occupational safety and decent working conditions to the worker. The proposed labor reforms initiative will reduce the complexity in compliance due to multiplicity of labor laws, because we just saw there are 44 central labor laws, but if they are shrunk or reduced to just four codes, then the management will be easy since the complexity is reduced. And these codes will facilitate, that is, it will help in setting up enterprises at a faster rate. Therefore, an environment for developing the business and industry in India will be created. And based on this, more employment opportunities will be generated without diluting the basic aspects of safety, security, and the health of workers. Here you need to note that the code on wages, that is to consolidate the laws relating to wages and bonus matters, has already been enacted by the parliament and it has also received the assent of the president. The code on wages has subsumed four labor laws. The four labor laws are Minimum Wages Act, then the Payment of Wages Act, then the Payment of Bonus Act, and finally the Equal Remuneration Act. After the enactment of the code, all the four acts stand repealed. This code on wages seeks to implement two main things. One is universalization of the provision of minimum wages, that is uniform minimum wages across country. Next is timely payment of wages to all the employees, irrespective of the sector, and the wage ceiling as per the new code. So this is about the code on wages. Know that the other three codes are at different stages of enactment. And this news article is about the draft code on social security and welfare. See, this news article tells that the draft code on social security and welfare subsumes about eight existing laws, which covers provident fund, maternity benefits, pension, etc. And public comments have been received for preparing this draft code by the central government. And know that this code is now at the drafting stage. It would further be worked upon after the recent round of public consultations. Now, let us look at some of the concerns with respect to the code on social security and welfare. The first concern is that the trade unions are against the proposal for provident fund, pension and insurance fund to be administered by a central board. And if you see, the other workers are demanding the provision for the right to social security for all and also for the establishment of a central apex council to be headed by the prime minister. So these are some of the concerns with respect to the proposed code on social security and welfare. See, this is an evolving news article. In this news article, we have tried to give an idea about the four codes, out of which one code has been enacted by the government. We shall discuss more on this code on social security and welfare and the other two codes in pipeline, which are the code on industrial relation and code on occupational safety, health and working conditions, as and when we receive the updates. Now, have a look at the practice question. Let us move on to the next news article. Now, see this news article. This news article is about maternal mortality ratio. This news article discusses about the special bulletin released by the sample registration survey on maternal mortality ratio from 2015 to 2017. And for the purpose of reporting, the sample registration system has categorized the states into three groups, as the Empowered Action Group states, then the southern states, and the other states and union territories. If you remember, we have discussed in detail about maternal mortality ratio, then about the sample registration system, and about the categorization of the states for the report by the sample registration system in our 9th November analysis, just the day before yesterday. So we suggest you to go through the entire analysis to have an overall idea about this topic. Now let's focus this picture. It tells that women in the age group between 20 and 24 and 25 to 29 are those section of population where huge number of maternal deaths have been recorded. Both these age groups comprise roughly 68% of the total maternal deaths that have happened between 2015 and 2017. Now, they've also given some factors that prevent women from receiving or seeking care during pregnancy and childbirth, like poverty, lack of information, then distance to the healthcare facilities, then unavailability of services, and also inadequate and poor quality healthcare services. And then also cultural beliefs and practices are also seen as a factor which prevent women from receiving or seeking healthcare during pregnancy and childbirth. From this news article, you can take both these data. And for overall subject clarity, please refer to our 9th November analysis on maternal mortality ratio. We have given the link in the description section and also in the comment section for this topic. With this, we come to the end of the analysis session of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion. Let us move on to the practice questions discussion session regarding the Election Commission of India. They have given three statements and they have asked you to choose the correct statements. Now look at the first statement. It tells that it is a constitutional body. Yes, the statement is correct. Note that the Election Commission of India is a permanent and an independent body established by the Constitution of India, mainly to ensure free and fair elections in India. This is defined in Article 324 of Indian Constitution. So the first statement is correct. If the first statement is correct, option B and D can be eliminated directly. Now all you need to know is if the statement 3 is correct or not. Now see the third statement. It tells that the Election Commission has the power to supervise and control the elections to the office of the President of India and the office of Vice President of India. Yes, this is also correct. It is provided in Article 324 of Indian Constitution. This article tells that the Election Commission of India has the power of superintendence, direction and control of elections to Parliament, state legislatures, then the office of the President of India, and also to the office of Vice President of India. So the correct answer to this question is option C, 1 and 3, 1B. But let us also see the second statement. The second statement tells that the tenure of the election commissioners is a term of 3 years or until they attain the age of 65 years, whichever is earlier. This statement is wrong. Know that the conditions of service and the tenure of office of the election commissioners shall be determined by the president. At present, they hold office for a term of 6 years or until they attain the age of 65 years, whichever is earlier. So the second statement goes wrong. The correct answer for this question is option C, 1 and 3 only. Now see this question. The question is, consider the following statements about Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. They have given three statements. Now see the first statement. It tells that Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee is responsible for appraisal of proposals relating to release of genetically engineered products into the environment, including experimental field trials. This statement is correct. This is one of the functions of the Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. Also, this Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee is responsible for appraising activities involving large-scale use of hazardous microorganisms and recombinants in research and industrial production from the environmental angle. So both these are the important responsibilities or the functions of Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. Now see the second statement. It tells that Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee has powers to take punitive action under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. Yes, this statement is also correct. This is also one of the functions of Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee. This committee, that is the Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee, or any persons authorized by this committee has powers to take punitive action under Environment Protection Act of 1986. So this statement is also correct. Now see the third statement. It tells that it functions under Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Now see the first two statements. It is related to environment, release of genetically engineered products into the environment, then to take punitive action under the Environment Protection Act of 1986. So you can make guess, at least if you do not know the ministry, that It functions under the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. So the third statement goes wrong here. Now this question asks which of the above statements are not correct. And here only the third statement is not correct. So the correct answer is option C, 3 only. Now see this question. The question is which among the following diseases are caused by the Aedes aegypti mosquito. They've given three diseases, malaria, chikungunya and dengue, and they've asked you to choose the correct answer. Here you need to know that malaria is caused by Plasmodium parasites. The parasites are spread to people through the bites of infected female Anopheles mosquitoes, which are called the vectors. And if you see, chikungunya is a viral disease which belongs to the genus Alpha virus. This virus is transmitted by the infected mosquitoes, which includes Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus mosquitoes, to humans who then suffer from chikungunya. And if you see, dengue is a mosquito-borne viral infection again. The dengue virus belongs to the genus Flavivirus and family Flaviviridae. The Aedes aegypti mosquito is the main vector here, which transmits the virus that causes dengue. So from our discussion, we can tell that chikungunya and dengue are caused by Aedes aegypti mosquito. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 2 and 3, since the question asks you to select the correct answer. See the next question. Which of the following pairs are correctly matched with reference to the enacted or the proposed codes with their respective ministries? So the codes are given on the left-hand side and the respective ministries are given on the right-hand side. And this question asks you to choose the correct answer, which means the correctly matched codes. Here know that only the first and the fourth pairs are correctly matched. And the second and the third pairs are incorrectly matched because both these codes, that is the code on industrial relations and the code on social security and welfare, also corresponds to the Ministry of Labour and Employment, since all these four codes revolve around labour's welfare. So the correct answer for this question is option B, 1 and 4 only. With this, we come to the end of today's analysis and also the practice questions discussion session. If you like the video, press the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.